Good afternoon, everyone. I hope I'm audible. ITEC welcomes all the participants for today's National Distance Learning Seminar Series. Today's topic is Neurological Manifestations in PLHIV, and speaker is Dr. Bipin Amin. Dr. Bipin Amin is currently the Professor of Medicine and Head of the Medical Unit at BJ Medical College and Civil Hospital in Ahmedabad. He is the program director of the COE BGMC and is also on the editorial board for six peer-reviewed scientific journals. He is a national training faculty for NACO for HIV care, support and treatment. He has been working in the field of HIV for over two decades now. He has authored and contributed modules on HIV-related topics in IGNU PG Diploma in HIV Medicine and WHO module on HIV and nutrition. He has authored many publications in index journals as well. We welcome you, sir, for today's NDLS session. I would request Dr. Amin now to kindly take over the session, please.
Thank you, Divya, for the introduction. At the outset, I will thank ITEC for inviting me to take session today on a neurological manifestation in PLHIV. Good afternoon to all attending seminar. This brings the greetings from Center of Excellence, BJMC, Ahmedabad. Today my session plan is like this. I'll be talking on the basics, how the neural axis involvement take place. Then we'll try to understand the common features, especially in PLHIV group, as the topic is. Then we'll briefly discuss about the approach of two specific presentations or diseases in PLHIV group, and then we'll discuss the common CNS infection management and other areas. Friends, as you know, this it's a neurological manifestation. It is a very, very long session, so I'll try to highlight the only important and the common one which are encountered by ART centers. So let us start with the basics of neurology and HIV. As you are aware that HIV, as soon as the HIV infection take place, within first 2 to 3 days or in the first week only, the brain get involved. And the beauty is that it persists in brain throughout the duration of the illness, irrespective of the stage of the HIV in that particular person. Of course, the degree of brain involvement or a neurologic involvement is not dependent on CD4 count. And if the person is on ART, may not always be associated with the improvement. So we'll see that more in the detail in a subsequent slides. If you see the what are the different areas of a neural system as in site of involvement, then it could be a meningeal involvement, cortical involvement in case of brain, spinal cord involvement, cranial and peripheral nerve, specific autonomic dysfunction can take place, and the muscles also. So these are the different sites which get involved in the neurology. Primarily, if you see, the HIV infection actually involves the CNS macrophage or a glial cells, and maybe secondary, this some damage is maybe secondary to release of a neurotoxin or toxic cytokines. These are the theories which are proposed for the understanding of neurological involvement. I hope my audio is audible. Am I audible to all? Okay. Okay. So, neurological disease may be the first manifestation in so many patients, and it has been reported in around 10 to 20% of infected person may present as a first manifestation, and when on a retrospect, he would be diagnosed to have an HIV reactivity on a lab test. 60% of the PLHIV, especially with stage 4, will have a clinically evident neural involvement which has been documented. Neurocognitive dysfunction is one of the condition which is associated with persistent immune activation and inflammation, and especially in case of an advanced HIV disease, sometimes you may not have a classical features. Like if the case of meningitis, we do expect the meningeal signs, but you may not have that signs in case of advanced HIV disease. And a simple thing is because the sometimes the inflammatory reaction may not be the standard or a normal which is expected in immune competent patients. So this was about the basics of the neural involvement which we are discussing. Now if I draw your attention to a presentation, how the PLHIV can come to AIT center, which are the symptoms which we should be alarming to medical officer or a healthcare team, that you know we would suspect the there is a neural involvement. Say for example, if the person is PLHIV is having headache which is bothering much, if somebody is having convulsion or seizures, having visual problems, either the patient or a relative or a spouse would say there is an altered sensorium or altered behavior, or if some as a routine follow-up, if you notice there is a decline in the cognitive functions. So these are neurological conditions or symptoms which needs to be taken care as a priority, and then such patients, even if it is a subclinical issues, you need to be more meticulous about taking care of this patient at AIT center. So the whenever you want to make an if you see this on this slide, I have divided the approach in a two part. To reach to a differential diagnosis, we always need a good history, and remember that history cannot be replaced by any investigations. Followed by thorough medical examination or a physical examination is important. At the same time, we need to remember what stage of HIV disease is there. Is it an early disease or a late disease? So these all factors which actually lead us to a proper differential diagnosis for the particular case. Say for example, if the patient is having headache, you need to take the history, what is the duration, what are the associated factors and all that, which as an basic medical officers we all know that. And to come to a etiological conclusion for the neurological disorder, we need to know, is this a primary HIV viral effect, or and if it is if primary HIV effect, is it an acute problem or a chronic problem? Second point would be, is it a secondary opportunity infection or a malignancy which is causing the particular symptoms? So that is how you can reach to a diagnosis. So many times it could be a simple other metabolic or a micronutrients derangement. Say for example, B12 problem. Okay, so that also we need to take in consideration. Complication of medical therapy, if the person is on Isonex and having a neuritis pain, then probably we need to know that this is a drug induced side effects. Or last but not least is this the symptoms or illness is unrelated to HIV infection? That is also a possibility, because all PLHIV can actually develop the non-HIV illnesses also the way other people develop. So these two important points is very, very important for a differential diagnosis and for an etiological consideration when we are dealing with this. As I said earlier, this slide shows that the neurological problem is primarily because of the two important points. Number one, it could be a primary to a pathogenic process of HIV infection itself, or as I said earlier, it could be a secondary to OI or some neoplasm like CNS lymphoma. If we discuss the primary, then the primary HIV related CNS problems can occur throughout the course of infections, and usually the pathogenic process is either inflammatory, demyelinating, or a degenerative in a nature. Inflammatory would be something like you can have a GBS kind of symptoms. Demyelinating will be something kind of a person will have the edema kind of symptoms, and a degenerative will be a gradual decline in a neurocognitive functions. So these are the ways. And another important point we need to remember is that multiple areas of nervous system may be involved simultaneously or one by one in a sequence also. Now this table is actually from the textbook of Harrison, and if I go in the detail, you can see here the primary HIV infection can cause an aseptic meningitis, HIV associated neurocognitive dysfunctions. It can cause a myelopathy or a spinal cord involvement. It can involve the peripheral nerves in form of GBS, in form of chronic inflammatory demyelinating disease. It can also cause a myeloneuritis multiplex, and it can also involve the muscle in form of myopathy. So these are the direct involvement. If I talk of a secondary CNS involvement, it would be usually opportunistic infection. So in our country, like cryptococcosis, toxoplasmosis, tuberculosis, these are common. Patient may have a primary CNS lymphoma or Kaposi's sarcoma. So these are the pathogenic mechanism or the way primary and secondary involvement of CNS take place. If I go in a syndrome wise, this slide is very busy slide, but if you see that it actually shows the syndromic presentation of a nervous system involvement. Say for example, if the person come with the headache, acute onset headache, vomiting, nausea, and neck pain or neck stiffness, then we always suspect the meningitis. And in that case, in our country, tuberculosis is the most common, followed by cryptococcosis. So this is how the meningitis. Syndrome can present in a PLHIV. The another is like a focal cerebral signs. If somebody is having a monoplasia or single localizing sign, then it could be simply because of the space occupying lesion, like a tuberculoma, toxoplasma lesion, PML, or even simple brain abscess or a neurosuccessor sarcoid. So these are the focal cerebral lesion. Person may come with the encephalitis. Encephalitis will primarily present with the convulsions, and where we need to understand the etiological agents like a cytomegalo, herpes simplex, or even local dissemination of toxo and HIV encephalopathy also. In case of peripheral neuropathy, it could be HIV associated distal sensory polyneuropathy. It could be antiretroviral drug induced neuropathy. Nowadays we are getting less number because we are cevidin is not our important initial part of therapy. Isoniazid is still we need to consider because we are using for patients are on IPT as well as on anti-tuberculosis therapeutic regime also. In case of spinal cord involvement, myelitis can be caused by herpes simplex virus, cytomegalovirus, like a neurosyphilis also, or a tuberculosis. Myelopathy would be, as I said, and I will be talking on vacuolar myelopathy also. B12 deficiency is very, very common even in a non-HIV population also. In that case, we need to consider that also. Myopathy or a direct muscle involvement could be HIV-induced myopathy. Sometime it could, zidovudine also can cause a myopathy. And a last important part is what we call HIV-associated neurocognitive dysfunction, or what we call HAND or HAND. Having said that, these are the either primary HIV-related incidences or because of a secondary OI or a malignancies, we need to remember that with the increase in the longevity of the PLHIV group because of the freely available antiretroviral therapy, this group of patients are also liable to get the simple like cerebrovascular accident. You can have an ischemic CVA like HIV associated metabolic complications, antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, DTP or infective endocarditis. So these can all can lead to ischemic cerebrovascular accident. So many of our patients may have a comorbidity like in hypertension. So they can have a hypertensive hemorrhagic cerebrovascular accidents. The drugs like a cocaine abuse can also cause a hemorrhagic CVA. So this slide is basically we need to remember that the apart from a primary HIV effect and secondary OI and malignancy involvement, these people can have the cerebrovascular accident either in form of ischemic CVA or hemorrhagic CVA. Now let us one by one see the algorithmic approach to a particular symptoms, and I would start with the simple diagnostic algorithm if the person comes with a headache. If there is a persistent or a severe headache which is interfering with the daily activities of the person, and if we examine the patient, if there is a febrile illness with neck rigidity, vomiting and alter sensorum or diplopia, these all patients need basic fundoscopic examination basically to rule out the highly raised intracranial pressures, and if the fundoscopy is normal, then these patients straight away need the CSF examination by lumbar puncture, and we'll discuss this how the CSF picture can suggest you. But say for example the patient of a headache, instead of presenting with the alter sensorium, which is we used to call a global syndrome, but if he has a headache with the focal seizures or localizing signs, then the better choice of investigation would be neuroimaging in a form of either CT scan or an MRI with the contrast. And if you have a ring enhancing lesion on your neuroimaging, then naturally your differential will be tuberculoma, toxoplasmo, neurosuccessor sarcoid or a primary CNS lymphoma. But if a person is having headache with focal signs, but if imaging is normal, next important investigation would be lumbar puncture analysis. Of course, along with the fundoscopy examination, and then you can go ahead with the serology also. So this is the basic approach. So primarily, if the PLHIV present with the global syndrome, your primary investigation would be fundoscopy followed by CSF analysis. But if there is a focal seizures or focal signs, then the primary investigation has to be a non-invasive like a neuroimaging, depending on the situation, contrast and non-contrast, followed by if the neuroimaging is normal, then you have to do for the CSF analysis. So that's about the headache examination. Say for example, if the patient comes with seizures, this is the reference from the Harrison textbook of medicine. And if you see that overall, like an HIV encephalopathy is the one of the important contributor to first time seizures in HIV positive patients. Toxoplasmosis is again second most common, followed by crypto, primary CNS lymphoma or progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Remember, these are the non-Indian data. Here, our most important point would be tuberculoma or tuberculosis involvement also. So this is the seizures, and seizures could be consequences of opportunity infection, which I discussed, because of the neoplasm, or it could be simply because of a primary HIV encephalopathy. One important point we need to understand is that it actually PLHIV have a lower seizure threshold, which is the meaning would be they are more liable to have a convulsive activity compared to the immunocompetent patients. And one of the studies have shown that they have a more chance of having an electrolyte disturbances compared to other people. So this electrolytemia is very, very common, and that sometimes contribute to more seizure in this group of patients. I would just touch upon the few points for the management part, that if you are dealing with the seizures, we need to be careful in selection of the antiretroviral drugs basically, and also in anti-epileptic selection also, because ART and anti-epileptic drug interactions are well known. The phenobarbital, phenytoin, carbamazepine, they are potent inducer of liver enzyme cytochrome P450, and they can basically lower the levels of antiretroviral drugs like protease inhibitor, non-nucleotides, and integrase inhibitor also. If someone asks me what is the important drug, then levetiracetam is considered to be a choice of a drug, because it has a broad spectrum of activity, so you can use it as a universal. It has a minimal drug interactions and a low side effect compared to other drugs. I will in between attend the questions. Question is from Mysuru. They are writing, recently they had a patient presented with seizure, CSF was normal, MRI shows tuberculoma / neurosis sarcoid, CSF sent for angiogram test and came negative. Shall we treat as a tuberculoma? Yes, we'll discuss this approach from the team Mysuru. I'll come to this area a little later in my presentations. So that was about the seizures. Let us go back to the other very important area, and which is known as an HIV associated neurocognitive dysfunction, or in short it is known as HAND or HAND. Now HAND is a disease spectrum actually. PLHIV with the neurocognitive dysfunction, if it is a very, very mild, it would be just asymptomatic impairment, which is picked up with the neuropsychiatric assessment. Ranging from asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment, it could be a minor neurocognitive disorder, or it could be a severe, clinically severe dementia, which we call HIV associated dementia or HAD. So, another important point is, even with a suppressive combination antiretroviral therapy or heart, 50% of PLHIV may have a mild to moderate cognitive impairment, especially if they are being assessed by very, very sensitive neuropsychiatric test. So basically, in a routine clinical busy OPD practice, you may not have the neurocognitive dysfunction assessment in detail, but whenever you have a complaint or a patient is symptomatic, we need to define whether they have a neurocognitive dysfunction also. So, what is actually HIV-associated neurocognitive dysfunction? It is also considered a subcortical dementia. You remember the Alzheimer's. So, Alzheimer's is in cortical dementia. This is subcortical. So, the lower part than the cortex is involved. And that is why characteristic is, this patient HIV-associated dementia is also referred what we used to call AIDS dementia complex or HIV encephalopathy, and which is one of the AIDS defining illness within our older criteria. HIV could be a late complication. It is a slowly progressive disease condition. It can be seen with the higher CD4 also more than 350. What is most important in our ART center practice that to define or to early pick up the neurocognitive dysfunction in pale HIV group, a baseline mini-mental scoring examination is important. So baseline MMSE, if it is done, then it will be very, very important on a prospective cognitive analysis whenever we are suspecting this over few more years at our ART center. Antiretroviral therapy is definitely beneficial in management of HAD, especially if it is started earlier, and it has been documented that in case of severe form, it is definitely important intervention. These are again the salient features of the HAND. As I said, usually they have a low CD4, they have acquired persistent cognitive decline, sometimes they may have a seizures. As I said, early symptom could be apathy, memory loss, slowing in understanding, and important part how to manage HAND is, yes, antiretroviral therapy is important as part of a management. Basically, we need to select the drugs for any neural involvement with PLHIV. You need to select the ART, which has a better blood-brain barrier and will have a good CNS penetration. So this slide shows the dolutegravir, zidovudine, abacavir. These are the drugs, or nevirapine. These are the drugs, or lopinavir. Drugs which has a high CNS penetration, and you know that lopinavir boosted is our part of ART regime in the country. Zidovudine is also part. The intermediate CNS penetration would be an lamivudine, efavirenz, raltegravir, and boosted darunavir. Remember that tenofovir has a poor CNS penetration. Atazanavir has a poor CNS penetration. So if you are suspecting, then probably this would be the, we need to select the drug either with the high or intermediate CNS penetration ability of this particular drug. This is again the assessment scale, so I'll not go in, I'll skip these slides as a part of assessment. Now let us come to the second symptomatic approach. In case of a meningitis, whenever you suspect a meningitis, the first question we need to ask, is it an acute meningitis? Are you suspecting this is an acute or in a chronic? So let us say, see in this slide, if the patient, this is an acute meningitis approach, patient present with the signs which are suggestive of acute meningitis in form of acute headache, mental status abnormality, neck stiffness with fever, then the second question is, does patient have a signs of sepsis or infection or patient looking toxic? If the patient is looking toxic, then initial treatment for acute bacterial meningitis is started, followed by fundoscopic examination to rule out the raised intracranial pressure, and then if the fundus is normal, these people should undergo the lumbar puncture examination. The empirical therapy would be a high dose like in ceftriaxone with vancomycin, which is standard empirical therapy. At the same time, when so you can start antibiotic, do a workup later, and always look for a common disease in PLHIV also, like they can also have in cerebral malaria or any other disease in particular area. But if this patient who is suspected of meningitis does not have any signs of toxic look or a unstable clinical condition, then straight away, instead of starting an empirical treatment in a previous case, here you can do a planned lumbar puncture. Depending on CSF analysis, you can either, if there is a lymphocyte dominance, then probably you can consider then tuberculous meningitis or aseptic meningitis, and if there is a more of a neutrophils on CSF, then probably you can think of a bacterial meningitis. So this is how the basic approach in a suspected case of acute meningitis in PLHIV group. Let us see the chronic meningitis approach. Here also patient is having history of chronic headache, fever, night sweat and other symptom. Then next question is to be asked is, does patient have any evidence of a focal deficit? If there is a focal deficit, then probably we'll discuss this in the focal deficit approach. But if there is a global syndrome, and remember this, I'm talking of a chronic meningitis. So here we will perform the lumbar puncture, and based on the cell count and other study, we can consider whether we want to consider this as a tuberculosis or some other conditions. If there is a signs of increased pressure, then somewhere there is a definite role of a neuroimaging also, because in that particular condition your CSM analysis will not be possible. This is the approach which here I said that the patient is suspected of chronic meningitis, but if there is any focal deficit evidence, then we need to follow this chart. And whenever there is a focal, the first investigation of choice would be neuroimaging. If the center is equipped with the MRI, then MRI or contrast and CT scan, where if the imaging is normal, then you can follow it by lumbar puncture. But if the imaging is showing the ring enhancing lesion, then you can consider tuberculoma, toxoplasmo, CSF sarcoid or a primary CNS lymphoma. So this is how what I have discussed is a flow chart for acute meningitis, chronic meningitis and focal neurological deficit. Let us now move to the in a later part. What I have done is we'll briefly look around the some identical or classical cases, and I'll also talk about some specific management. Mysore is saying, sir, kindly put a light on CNS CSF escape since the current ART are less potent CNS penetration. I'll come to this part with later. So a general principle for management of CNS OI is the person who is having CNS OI is a seriously ill patient and will require the indoor management. We need to follow the algorithm which is mentioned previously, which in my previous slides. So basic principle in managing here that we need to treat the causative organism based on the flow chart, whatever you have come to a diagnosis. We also need to treat the raised intracranial pressures with mannitol or flow restriction, whatever the need of time is. If the patient is having treatment, patient is having seizures, we need to treat the seizures also with the specific anticonvulsion, which I have already briefed earlier. We need to remember the drug-drug interaction, which I have already said. And as I said, the levetiracetam and the valproate will be a preferred choice to avoid the drug-drug interactions. I'm sure that few of medical officers will be aware of this case. This case is a young male patient with a CD4 of 49 cell, presented with the headache, fever and fatigue, and was having an altered sensorium. And if you see here where the arrow is, you can see the typical molluscum like skin lesion on this face of this, and there were no signs of any systemic or neurological signs. Okay, so what could be the differential diagnosis and what further investigation we can do? Yes, Dr. Datta from STMSI, cryptococcosis. Yes, anyone else you want to add? You can type in your answer for the possible differential diagnosis. I'll wait for a minute for other people also to type. Dr. Swami is saying cryptococcosis. Yes. Dr. Joshi is saying tuberculoma. So most of all of you are having the understanding that either is a cryptococcosis. Okay, so let us see that what is the continue. We continue with the case. So as all of you have said that it could be cryptomeningitis, could it be bacterial meningitis? It could be tuberculosis meningitis. So these are the differential diagnoses. Whenever you suspect that this case is of a meningitis. So in these patients, here is the CSF analysis. Was opening pressure of 350 water, WBC were total 10, all 100% lymphocytes, 70 milligram percent was the protein and 40 milligram of a glucose, with the blood glucose corresponding 124. CSF subunit was negative, VDL was negative, and CT scan was negative. So, what is your answer? Does this person has a meningitis? You can type your answer. Does this patient is having meningitis? Okay, so yes, answer is yes, there is a meningitis in this case because of two important points. There is an increased CSF pressures, a 10 cells is higher, normally anything between 1 to 4 CSF cell is a normal, and there is a definite increase in the CSF protein. So this is the case of meningitis, yes. Dr. Datta has already written. Okay, so this is what the CSF analysis. So if the CSF cells, biochemistry and microscopy can guide a clinician whether the CSF picture suggestive of cryptococcus, tuberculosis, pneumococcus or syphilis. So in case of cryptococcus, is primarily a lymphocytic, maybe normal cells, but definitely low sugar and elevated proteins, and India in preparation would be positive. Your crypto antigen test also would be positive. Is there any question? Yes, okay. If it is a tuberculosis, then again it is a lymphocytic predominant, but the total number would be higher compared to crypto. Again, lower normal sugar with the elevated protein, but here the subunit would be directing us more like other bacterial, like a pneumococcus would be a streptopneumonia, would have a neutrophilic CSF with large number of sometime in the thousands, with a very very high protein, very very low sugars, and gram stain will guide us. And in case of a syphilitic involvement, again it is a lymphocytic but moderately or mildly elevated, little high protein, near normal sugar, and VDRL will guide us from this area. So this is how the CSF analysis can guide us in correlation with the other area. So all of you are very well aware the crypto is caused by neoformans, which is the most common fungal infection in PLHIV group. Usually it occurs when there are low CD4 count, preferably more than 200 cells, and untreated cryptococcal is the outcome is not favorable. All of you know the clinical features is standard with the fever, headache, with malaise, neck stiffness, lethargy, altered mentation, personality changes also there. There may be pulmonary and skin lesion which was like in this patients. So this is how the crypto clinical features is. Dr. Uday Joshi, do we need to do all this CSF investigation in meningitis in PLHIV? Yes, but not all on the same time, but sequentially, because depends on what you are suspecting. So we need to do, suppose if CBNAT is a standard, so you need to send in CBNAT examination. So if I go back, the all investigation would be, I'll go back to one more slide for the CSF, that yes, you need a CSF analysis, you need an India in preparation if you are suspecting crypto. CBNAT is a standard available, you need to do a glucose also. So in that context, yes, Dr. Joshi, all CF analysis tests are required. Depending on a serology, whether you or antigen or the other serological CSF test, depends on the availability and the clinical suspicion. The management of a crypto is also known to all of us, but remember that there are specific phases. That during induction, we need a short course induction regime with the nephrotensin B. The dose is all as I have written, and along with these are the WHO the guidelines for the diagnosis of crypto and management, which was released in March 2018. So amphotericin with the fluoxytocin divided into four doses is important as an induction. And if suppose if you do not have these available, then probably you can alternate option for induction would be fluconazole along with fluoxytocin also. And then you need a consolidation phase maintenance with the fluconazole, especially in adult and children in different dose after the induction phase. And then you need maintenance or second prophylaxis with a fluconazole 200 milligram daily until the recommendation for the maintenance phase is there. Dr. Swami is asking from Mysore about the pulmonary cryptococcosis in the treatment. Dr. Swami, I may answer you separately, because currently we are discussing neuro area. So pulmonary management can be done a little later or in another session also. One important caveat is that routine use of adjuvant steroid therapy during induction phase is not recommended, which we need to understand in this management part. That brings to another case where this is the female 32-year-old patient with the presented with a focal convulsion, and examination revealed the right upper limb weakness or a monoparesis. There were no other abnormality, and you can see here the contrast CT finding was suggestive of a 1, 2 and 3 ring enhancing lesions involving the both the cortical hemisphere with the surrounding edema. If you can see here, the black one is an edema, okay, and if you see the midline, there were no midline shift. So what could be the differential diagnosis in these patients? You can type your answer. Yes, Dr. Swami is saying toxo or tuberculoma. Yes, Dr. Alka Vagila is saying tuberculoma. And then of course the second question is how you approach about the neurological deficit. Okay, so all of you agree that there are for a solitary lesions or a ring enhancing lesions, you have this differential diagnosis. So in such a scenario with the biocortical involvement without midline shift, probably, and this is image courtesy from Tambaram, Chennai, It could be toxo, tuberculoma, neurosis, or it could be brain abscess or primary CNS lymphoma. So all of us are correct in provisional impression. So what you will, this is how the approach is. I already dealt with this slide in earlier part. This is how you will diagnose. Now, if you are suspecting this is toxo, then once you have done this neuroimaging, you can do a toxoplasmo serology, and or you can actually do a presumptive toxoplasmosis treatment also. So as you know, toxoplasmosis present with the features of encephalitis like a seizures and localizing signs, sometimes with the altered mental state. Focal signs are common, like in this patient there was a monoplegia, or you can have an hemiplegia also, some cranial involvement are also there. ELISA is important because it will be positive for in more than 95% of the patients, with a reported range of 22 to 95%. And of course, if somebody asks a question, definite diagnosis is brain biopsy, which is purely an intervention. So usually we don't do that. Presumptive diagnosis can be made based on the character presentation which we have done, and of course you can start at toxoplasma therapy and see the response. So the preferred regimen here is a pyrimethamine in 200 milligram, followed by dose like if it is less than 60 weight or more than 60 kg of weight, you can plan accordingly. If pyrimethamine sulfadiazine is not available, then you can use and try metoprolol sulfadiazine combinations, or your is also there. You can have an alternate regimen with the cotrimoxazole, pyrimethamine, as I said. All this patient would require the chronic maintenance therapy with cotrimoxazole tablet, and all of you know the guidelines there, where they need to remain asymptomatic with the at least two CSF in sequence for more than 6 months. If it is normal, then probably you can stop the secondary prophylaxis. So this part is known, so I will go little hurry. Dr. Swami from Mysore, the question is, in OPD we routinely do toxo IgM by card. Some of them will be tested positive. Does that require CT MRI to rule out CNS toxo, or just give empirical therapy? I understand you are doing in toxo IgM by the card, by the whole blood. And is it a routine in which group of patient? All of your OPD patients are tested with a toxo IgG? So asymptomatic screening, I understand that Dr. Swami, the asymptomatic screening, all new cases, yes, all new cases probably, and if they have a symptom, you need to investigate them further. Dr. Kamti, at Center Kamti is asking, what is the duration of maintenance therapy? As I said, maintenance therapy for toxo is until your two CSF 6 months apart is more than 200 or then and then you can stop it. So until your two CSF, so that's an immune recovery is there, then and then you will stop the secondary prophylaxis. So that brings to another case. This is a 46-year-old female, CD4 was 44 cells, and she presented to at a center with incoordination of right hand, unsteady gait, and a speech problem. This was a thin-built woman, but she was fully conscious and oriented. Her vital were normal, you can see here, no fever. She has a right slight facial droop, right hand weakness, dysmetria or overshooting through on examination, unsteady gait due to mild right leg weakness. So what is the probable diagnosis? You can type your answer. For the sake of all, yes, Dr. Alka Vagila said PML, Dr. Swami is also. Yes, so you see this is amazing. Okay, and if you are particular in this area, if you see large hyper intense image on MRI. So yes, all of you are right, it is a progressive multifocal leukoid capillopathy. Here the multiple areas of high intense signal is there. So what is PML? All of you know it is multifocal demyelination because of the JC virus. It produces a progressive neurological syndrome spreading from week to month. Typical presentation is a focal signs along with cognitive dysfunction, gait abnormality, speech abnormality, sometimes cranial nerve involvement, and classical is occipital lobe, frontoparietal and posterior fossa. So these are the important sites. So on your neuroimaging, if you have an occipital lobe or a cerebellum involvement, probably in the PLHIV, we should always think of PML. Lab diagnosis can be detected by PCR, which is I am sure not the routine test done. CSF specimen JC can be detected. Important point is the negative test does not include PML, and that's why we always have to give a thought of for this diagnosis on a clinical ground. Unfortunately, there's no specific treatment, but you need to optimize the antiretroviral therapy, meaning that this patient you need to check for the treatment failure or whether the virological suppression is there or not. So you can further evaluate this patient on whatever regime they are, just confirm that the drugs are effective, and that is what I call the ART optimizations. The another case is the 34-year-old young male, CD4 146, having involuntary movements of all limbs, difficulty in walking, memory and slurring of speech, and the wife says that this is happening progressively since last 3 months. He is disoriented on examination and his mini mental score was 18 out of 30. Okay, so what is the diagnosis? You can type your answer. Yes. So somebody wrote it's age, dementia. Very true. So this is what I was talking of, age dementia. Okay. I think this I have discussed. The other areas, tuberculoma, tubercular abscess, we have already discussed. I think this slide is misplaced. So all of you are right, it is the age dementia complex, and where again you have to do an ART optimization. Let us briefly touch upon if somebody is having visual problem, then we need to consider the retinitis also, which is common manifestation, and all of you know the cytomegalovirus is the common important consideration in this group of patients. Ocular examination, fundoscopy is essential, especially when you are dealing with the low CD4 count less than 100. So always perform the fundoscopy as an essential test, whosoever come with the headache which is persistent or having the fever. CMV retinitis usually occur unilaterally, but equally there is report of a bilateral too. Peripheral retinitis might be asymptomatic. So until you see the CSF, you may not pick up the patient may be asymptomatic. And CNS retinal lesions, central retinal lesions are associated with the defects. Treatment suppression of infection is important. We need to prevent the relapse. So immediate life-threatening condition, rather sight-threatening conditions there, then intravitreal gencyclovir or first-standard injections are given. Valganciclovir is important as a preferred drug, or you can use an oral drug also in this group of patient. And as a matter of rule, we need to have a maintenance phase to prevent the virus from causing a relapse, where valganciclovir is important, and then a day therapy. So this is about the brief about the area. Then I said in a presentation that you need to understand the cord involvement also. So vascular myelopathy is important area in this group, where person may have a weakness, spasticity. So these all suggest the peripheral nerve involvement, bladder and bowel incontinence, altered knee jerk, and all of you know the pathology is there. Important point, when there's a spinal cord involvement, it could be the important differential in our country would be always look for a comprehensive myelopathy, most common reason being tuberculosis, sometime a spinal lymphoma, B12 deficiency causing the spinal cord involvement is important. Here the investigation of a CSF will be usually low. If you do a CSF, small number of area in the imaging is may be normal, and the because it has a spasticity kind of therapy, the physiotherapy rehab is important, and antiretroviral therapy will be of helpful. Neuromuscular weakness syndrome is another clinical entity where person will have an ascending paresis and areflexia with or without cranial involvement. Lactate and CPK would be raised in these patients. EMG and CV may suggest the axonopathy or myopathy, and this patient required the supportive riboflavin therapy. So this is the brief about neuromuscular weakness syndrome. Dr. Datta from STM is asking, if the person gives history of a near blindness for 2 months at presentation to clinic, what are the chances of reversal with gencyclovir? That depends on the, if there is a very high grade of an involvement of the optic disc, then there will probably recovery may not be 100%. So the friends, the very large topic, I tried to highlight the important areas of a key message, like how to always rule out the neurological involvement in all PLHIV, especially those in are on advanced cases. OI and CNS malignancies are always possibility in this group of patient, especially with the low CD4 count. In our area, tuberculosis and cryptococcosis are the main differential diagnosis or meningitis cases. Focal symptom would be toxo, tuberculum or PML. We need an algorithm approach to decide which investigation first, followed by second, to save the time and resources. Ophthalmic examination is necessary to rule out the CNS retinitis, and increasing survival of HIV infected patient because of the ART program. We need to understand that certain differential diagnosis is very, very important. That brings to end of my today's presentation. There was a mention of I think Dr. Swami asked about the CSF viral escape. Yes, the CSF viral escape is a phenomenon where HIV RNA can be detected in CSF when the plasma levels are undetected, which is, this is the condition which is called as CSF viral escape. And this is the important area where I can retrieve what was a question, but that's the CSF viral escape is not very, very common. And all of you know that the HIV virus do replicate in the remote areas of a brain also, along with the lymphoid tissue. So probably that is area. So with that, I thanks the NACO officials, all NACO officials, other COE for sharing their images also, and these are the references from where the basic framework of this is done. So I thanks once again all of you for attending, and thanks ITEC for inviting me. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir, for this informative session today.
So Divya can take over now. Over to Divya for ITEC.
All participants are requested to kindly enter the